I paint an apocalyptic picture and also a picture of great, great salvation from severe troubles, actually, that are besetting us. There is this cosmic colonial, cosmic corporate culture, it's also colonial too, that has long had designs on this planet and has had a blueprint of how to incorporate this planet into the cosmic corporate culture. And indeed, this planet has been incorporated. We're now a colonial outpost of the cosmic corporate culture. And there's also a spiritual culture, a cosmic spiritual culture. Here's the difference. The cosmic spiritual culture is aware of the cosmic corporate culture and knows all the ways and means and how they operate. And the cosmic corporate culture is really quite oblivious in a lot of ways, very oblivious to cosmic spiritual culture. It views the cosmic spiritual culture as something to get rid of and ignore, and so it just doesn't exist. It doesn't want to exist. It says it doesn't belong in existence. But keep in mind, the cosmic spiritual culture appears in existence in order to liberate us from existence. What is existence? It's like a dream. It's actually a belief system. It's a belief system. A system of beliefs. Cosmic spiritual culture is designed, its purpose is to help us set down this dream of disempowerment, which is what existence is all about. It's a dream of disempowerment, a dream of spiritual disempowerment. Cosmic corporate culture wants to empower disempowerment. That's its goal. Wants to empower disempowerment. So the two cultures, one, the cosmic corporate culture has no use for cosmic spiritual culture at all and wants it to vanish forever and stop bothering it. So it's when this cosmic corporate culture incorporates a planet, as has happened here on planet Earth, there's an educational and cultural momentum towards becoming oblivious to cosmic spiritual culture and replacing it with pop spirituality, corporate spirituality, with no real momentum to it. And then that too is swept away. And so we have on this planet now an extreme amount of extremists who are ignorant, totally ignorant of cosmic spiritual culture. And as far as they know, it's never existed. And they don't even know what it is. It's just a blank there. And this is seen as progress. Progress here. This is seen as progress. So there's a vast, vast gulf between the two. And the ones who have to reach across and bridge, this cosmic spiritual culture has to bridge that gulf. But on this planet, it's becoming so severe that it's getting more and more difficult to bridge this gulf here on this planet at this time. this is the apocalyptic nature of our times, right, guys? We're going to 215. It's a very apocalyptic year. Lifting of the curtain, apocalypse, lifting of the curtain upon the designs of cosmic corporate culture. The designs. From the standpoint of cosmic spiritual culture, this cosmic corporate culture is an abomination. It's an absolute abomination because it avoids the one responsibility that we all have, which is to gently set down this attempt to spiritually disempower ourselves. We have no choice in this responsibility because we can't disempower ourselves. So this attempt will never get anywhere. And it's ultimately totally futile. It's futile right now. It's always futile. And serves no purpose for us whatsoever. It's just fearful, fearful, fearful. We don't like it. We don't want to continue with it. There's nowhere to go with that except to set it down. Nowhere to go with it except to set it down and say, I'm not interested in trying to disempower spirit anymore. Spiritual disempowerment, I'm not interested in anymore. That's the only where to go with it is to set it down. I mean, there is nothing else to do with it. So to avoid that responsibility, to avoid even making any effort whatsoever, is really an abomination. It's an absolute waste of time. This cosmic corporate culture is a total waste of your time, of everyone's time. But the people here in this world, spirits who are trying to disempower themselves by identifying with this dream we call planet Earth and human bodies, this wishful thinking, really, because it symbolizes disempowerment. There's no real disempowerment, but we can symbolize disempowerment and then play with those symbols. Sequence the appearancing of these symbols to make it seem like there's disempowerment taking place, but it's all just like a fantasy. It's our imagination. There's just not an awareness in this world, hardly, that there's a way to set this down, and that there are those who have done it, that those who accepted this responsibility and set down this attempt to disempower themselves, disempower spirit, that there's a culture, there's a way, there's a culture, there's a discipline, there's a whole culture of a spiritual, cosmic spiritual culture. They're simply unaware of this, becoming extremely unaware, and more to the point, very antagonistic to it, very phobic. Truthophobic, spiritophobic, whatever, phobic. There, any mention of it, it's just like you freak out. You go down and, interview her in the street. Give me your reaction to this work. I'm going to give you a saint, your reaction. What are you, some wise ass, what are you talking about? Saint, huh? I think, it's just, most people would like, I don't know, I'm not supposed to know this stuff, There's all sorts of meta messages in cosmic corporate culture. So much is implied that you're not supposed to know about this. You're not supposed to look in this direction. Your attention is not supposed to go there. You're wrong, you're bad if your attention goes there. And this is very cleverly enculturated. This present culture has so much enculturated in it that is not even recognized until you try to get free of it. And then it seems like an endless swamp. What most people do here in the world is just assume, oh, this is it, this is fine, everything's great. and I'm just going to enjoy as much as I can, and that's it. So they don't realize how much their attention is being controlled through fear. And it's only when we try to escape this trap of fear that we run into all these troubles and difficulties. This cosmic corporate culture is extremely heavily defended against responsibility and truth out of desperate fear. You see, the fundamental problem that we struggle with is not a problem, but the fundamental delusion is that if we don't find a way to disempower ourselves, this will anger God so much that God will annihilate us. And so we're extremely heavily defended against any notion of setting down this attempt to disempower ourselves, thinking that this will result in our annihilation. So we don't even want to know that there's a way, that there's a cosmic spiritual culture. We want to believe that happiness comes from there not being any way to set it down. No way. It's never happened. Happiness comes from saying, oh, it's never happened. Saints, they're delusional. You know, all religion, delusional. It's a delusional. This is what cosmic corporate culture inculturates in everyone. Is all that stuff is just mythical, delusional. Actually, it's an aberration in the brain, is what they say. And then people say, oh, good. And they say, oh, there's some treatment. We're working on, you know, the right medication for it. Anybody who suffers from this should be able to easily be treated, not spread this problem around. Oh, good. Okay. Phew, what a relief. Yeah. This is literally what is taking place in this planet right now. Most people are absolutely petrified if you suggest that there's actually a way to set down the entirety of spirit's attempt to disempower itself. Pointing out that all of existence is this attempt to disempower itself. Anything that has to do with form, anything that has to do with form at all, is this attempt to disempower ourselves. This spirit attempt on the part of spirit to disempower itself, change reality. So most of us in the world now don't want to know. Don't want to get anywhere near that. There's a massive taboo. So don't dare look behind that door or you will be annihilated. This is what they believe. So of course when you're trying to work out of this, you have a lot of fear because the whole culture believes that if you look behind this door, you'll be annihilated. Not only that, you'll annihilate everybody else in the entire universe. You'll be the cause of it all. This is how strong the taboo is. And it is all 100% total nonsense. And yet, if you look behind the door and see that, and you tell others, they'll go, you're a pariah. How dare you suggest that we, you know, break this taboo that is so important to us. We feel it's like it's our very life. We believe our life depends upon not looking behind that door, not looking behind the curtain. We believe our very life depends upon it. And if we do, look behind, we'll be annihilated. So this is quite a nasty trap, isn't it? Because looking behind the curtain, we'll see, oh, there's no annihilation at all. God is not displeased at us in the slightest bit. In fact, it's impossible for God to be displeased in us in any way. There's zero possibility of us ever being annihilated. Zero possibility. And then we see this is all nonsense. We wanted to try to be greater than God. So we the only way we could do this is try to change the will of God. And since the will of God is that it's impossible to disempower ourselves. All is always empowered. Always. All we could do is to try and prove that we are greater than God is to try and disempower ourselves. And we've been having this dream of disempowerment. But we can't do it. So to motivate ourselves, We believe that God created us specifically with the function to figure out how to disempower ourselves, and that then if we fail in that, God is going to annihilate us because we fail to function as God created us to function. Along with the additional fear that if we don't function that way, that we're not functioning the way God willed for us to function. Therefore, we are actually disempowering God, which would disempower us. You see, it's a quagmire. It's a quagmire of fear, actually. All of it just made up by us. We just made it all up. None of it is true. But we thought that maybe if we just motivated ourselves through fear, that we could figure out how to do it. You see, we couldn't find out how to do it. And of course, there is no way to do it. But we believe that maybe if we just make ourselves super fearful, that we'll somehow find the way that God is hiding this from us. And it's difficult to get to. But if we're just fearful enough of thinking we have to get to it, otherwise we'll be annihilated, that this will somehow enable us to get to it. So this is what we're trapped in this cosmic corporate culture, is a defense system that we are utilizing, that we have made, we have imagined and believed in, that defends us against cosmic spiritual culture, which reveals the truth to us. It defends us against it. So we believe it doesn't exist. It's never existed. There's no use for it. Totally not understandable. It's dangerous. It's very dangerous. And should be gotten rid of entirely. This is a defense system. So when this cosmic corporate culture defense system incorporates a planet like this planet, then you have a situation that we have now where it's quite difficult to spread the good news. It's quite difficult to spread the good news in this world. The good news that this we made all this up. We made it all up. And every perfection is still absolutely perfect. We're still completely empowered. All is still completely empowered. Nothing ever happened. Nothing at all has ever happened. Reality is exactly the way that it's always been and always will be. Nothing else ever happened. There's only reality, always. Nothing else has ever happened at all, in spite of all our dreams and wishes and imaginations and fear. This is the good news. Now, even when we look behind the curtain and realize that there's no cause for fear whatsoever, the lack of familiarity with reality that we have causes a severe fear in us also. Continuity fear, I call it. And we say, wow, I don't know how I would function. I've been believing that my functionality is suspect and has been changed, and has been disempowered, and now I realize that it hasn't at all. Well, how do I function then? We're frightened of that. Frightened of our own perfection, our own empowerment, the empowerment of all perfection of reality, but frightened of it. So we have this continuity fear. So we have these taboos against looking at this, and then when we do look at it, we have this continuity fear. Not a very pretty picture, actually. Quite difficult situation. So for most, they just say, hey, let's make the most of this cosmic corporate culture we have. I mean, we're getting all these cosmic goodies now, right? All this stuff that comes from the bigger corporation that we didn't have previously, before we were incorporated here on planet Earth. We didn't have all this stuff. Now there's all this whiz-bang scientific technology stuff, And we think, let's just make the most of it. Let's just try to live a good life, and we don't feel bad. Let's take medications, and just believe that everything is just all getting better, and that's it. That's what most people's lives are. That's it. They're unaware of this cosmic, spiritual culture that we have access to, actually. Such is the apocalyptic plight of planet Earth right now, December 11th, 2014. Now, this defense against truth, against responsibility, continues on rapidly, desperately searching for better and better defenses. And it certainly gets very bizarre, and goes from bizarre to very bizarre to very, very bizarre, and on and on and on like that. Innumerable styles of defensiveness. And so it just keeps on going and going and going and going and going. What else does it have to do except defend against truth? If you're defending against truth, you just have to keep going and going and going. There's no ultimate defense against truth where you say, okay, I finally reached a defense that works. I don't have to do anything more. No, there's always more because it doesn't work. Because truth is still true. We're still attracted to truth. We still know truth intuitively. We know truth within. We know. And so we have to keep defending and defending and defending. And this defense gets old. We've got to have a new one. So we're constantly changing. Constantly changing. We're constantly innovating new defenses. And so you may come into the world with your set of defenses that you're... Your generation is used to. This is how we defend against truth. Next generation got totally different defenses. And they think they're it and you're an anachronism. And then the next generation after them, they got a totally new defense. And they say you're an anachronism. And it goes on and on and on and on like this. And then, of course, there's this corporate, cosmic corporate bureaucracy that many try to get into, and they're sort of, they feel like they're sort of managing the whole thing, you know, and making sure that all these defenses, that there's all this pluralism and tolerance and diversity and defensiveness, thinking, let's get as much different types of defensiveness as possible, you know, and more the merrier. So they're administrating the whole thing, you know, the administrators, the bureaucrats. And they really have no idea of how cosmic spiritual culture really runs its business. They have no idea. They have no idea. No clue. Clueless of what it's really about. But of course they think they know everything, because that's defensiveness is saying, there's nothing that we cannot defend against. And having to defend against truth, what else can they believe? They have to believe that they can ignore everything, you know, successfully ignore everything. Whatever you say about truth, oh yeah, it's like this. In other words, something it's not like. It's like this, and then focus on that, you know, that takes their attention away from truth. So if you say yes to them, they'll say, oh, you said no, okay. No, that sounds good to me. No, yeah, it's no. I said yes, huh? No, you didn't, you said no. So obviously, they're going to say truth doesn't exist as it is. They're going to distort it and put their attention on the distortions of it to avoid it, keep their attention off of it. It's really a play of attention, all of this. So, apocalyptic times are upon us. Apocalyptic times are upon us. Where it gets so bad, where we become incorporated. When you're incorporated here, you're from the county, for instance, they put in, they pave your street, they put in sidewalks, they put in street lights, they collect taxes, and you're hooked up, you're incorporated into the system. So when they incorporate this planet Earth, incorporation of planet Earth, everything changes here, and you're put under regulation. You're now regulated. You're part of the greater corporate body, cosmic corporate body. Of course, they tell you that this incorporation is your enlightenment, is your salvation, is your ascension. What else can they say? Of course, they're going to keep your attention on what they're doing, and how better do it than to claim it's your ascension, it's your happiness, it's your salvation, it's freeing you from fear, you know, to be incorporated. They keep your attention away from what really works. They keep your attention on what doesn't work, and then label it as if it does work. So, this reign of error, we could call it reign of error in this world. Misdirection, reign of misdirection. But most people feel we're advancing, we're ready to ascend into some, you know, something much, much better. Really, what we're really talking about is we feel we're going to get a hold of better defenses that work better. We're always dissatisfied with our defenses against truth. Because they don't work. We don't need any of this. God is not threatened. What is real cannot be threatened. What is unreal doesn't exist. Reality cannot be threatened in any way. We have not threatened reality. God is not mad. There's no fear. There's no vulnerability. So we don't need this defense system at all. The universe, nature, planet Earth, all of this. We don't need it. And it's this that frightens us. Ultimately, I say the continuity fear is at this root of it now, because we've had this play for so long. When we realize that we don't need this, we get frightened and say, no, I need the universe. I need all this, you know, I need nature. I need this. This is what I'm used to. What would I do without it? I can't. So this is a continuity fear. So I say the continuity fear is at the root of the situation, ultimately, because if it wasn't there, we would certainly set it all down and say, oh, I don't need this, no problem, goodbye. But we keep claiming, no, we need it. And it kind of, because we have this continuity fear, and then we think, well, I got to hold on to this, so why don't I just say I need it? Then that feeds the fear of thinking that we actually do need it, because if we don't succeed in disempowering ourselves, God's going to annihilate us. So the two fears feed one another, but ultimately the continuity fear is the one we have to work on. Because that is a pragmatic fact that we are frightened to set down nature, universe, form, and realize that we don't need it at all. It was all symbolic. It was all simply symbolic dance of disempowerment. It was all that it really was. We don't need it. We're afraid to realize we don't need it, so we rationalize it, say, no, this is interesting, this is important, this dance is somehow we got to keep dancing. And so we'll grab a hold of some type of dance and say, no, this is it, you know, this is really, really enjoyable, I like this, I need this, I want this, I don't want to let go of it. And rationalize it, and build all sorts of rationalization around us. It's a continuity fear. The fact is, if we had no continuity fear at all, we would set this all down and absolutely forget it as if it never existed. Just like that. It's as if it's some kind of dreadful imprisonment. And that we just want to forget it. No more. No more interest in playing with pure potentiality in that way. No more. So it is. Our problem is the continuity fear. And then not recognizing that, we rationalize that there's some dance that we really feel like, yeah, I really want to do this. This is really important. I need to do this. And how dare anyone suggest that this is not really important, that God, you know, smiles upon this in terms of needing me to do this, wanting me to do this, specifying to do this, and whatever. This is all rationalization. So when we start working with the continuity fear directly, then these rationalizations start to fall apart, and we realize they're just rationalizations, and we stop trying to do all these dances of disempowerment. We're not really interested in them anymore. We just say, no, I'm not really interested in that. Oh, but I need to go travel, I need to do this. No, I don't really need to do that anymore. Not necessary. So you kind of just, it just becomes easy where you just simply are not attractive anymore. They'd say, I don't need to do that. This is the benefit. These rationalizations, just to say, I don't need to rationalize. I know this is the continuity fear. I know I can evaporate the continuity fear through right spiritual practice. So I don't need to continue rationalizing, being stuck and claiming that, no, this is something I really want to do. some whatever, you know, that's wasting our time. What happens when we recognize the continuity fears at the root of our trouble, we work on it, begin to work on evaporating it, then we find the spiritual path is what we really want to do, because it works. It works. Saves us time. Now, we live in this apocalyptic time, meaning the incorporation of planet Earth is being completed, and the rollout of corporate control, cosmic corporate incorporation of this planet, the cultural rollout of that is quite extreme. Has been going ongoing for quite some time, but the momentum is almost exponential, actually. And those who may have had experience of this in other times and other places where they lived on a planet that was incorporated understand what can happen. And so they're the ones who are very jittery in this world now. They thought they found a planet where they could not be bothered by this cosmic corporate culture, not be incorporated. They don't want to be incorporated. It's like the country folks don't want to be incorporated in the city, you know. And here, but here, they, you know, they got found out. You know, they thought they could hide here, couldn't hide, and so they're very upset about that, for sure. But this is not the same as the cosmic spiritual culture, which is largely unconcerned about it, knowing that they have options, supernature, they have options. They don't have to keep searching for some planet that, you know, to hide from this Leviathan, this juggernaut, this terrible force that keeps gobbling up, incorporating planets. Supernature is available, which cannot be touched. Doesn't keep changing, doesn't have all these cultural changes, all these defense systems keep changing. No, it stays the same. It's just this incredible, beautiful, peaceful. I can't even describe how wonderful it is. We have options of enlightenment, we have options to set this down. There are options. And these options are not understood by cosmic corporate culture. At all. They don't understand this at all. They think it's just a fantasy. That's silly to think about, talk about it. That's silly. There's nothing like that. Because they don't understand it. They're so fear-ridden and defended against truth that their attention can't begin to put it into any context, appropriate context. They don't have the context to appreciate it. They simply do not have it. So it goes unappreciated. It's an orphan. Truth is an orphan in this world. I had that dream long ago where I came across this orphan, this little child, orphaned by the side of the road, and I picked it up and I said, nobody wants it. I said, you want it? And nobody wanted it. I went and I tried to find the parents, nobody claimed it. I said, no, we don't know anything about this. Get out of here. Very rude and angry towards me. What was that orphan? The little child was truth. Truth is an orphan here. Nobody wants it. That's why they say that the story of Jesus, Mary and Joseph couldn't find any place to have birth in a manger, or, that's one of the stories. And it points out that truth is an orphan here. We're all saying, no, stay away. This frightens us. But we've really just frightened ourselves. There isn't really anything to be frightened of. Reality is not a frightful situation at all. But we presume that it must be because we can't hardly imagine how could we have frightened ourselves to such a large extent. Well, keep in mind that we're an extension of God, who is all creative, all powerful. We have the creative ability to imagine whatever we want to imagine. So if we want to imagine that we're scaring ourselves, we can elaborate upon that endlessly, actually. So that's what we've done. We certainly have the power to confuse and frighten ourselves and make this vast symbolic dream, fantasy of great complexity, so much so that it seems almost real. You know, we were able to do that, and we have done it. So the continuity fear is a very severe fear, because really, we're caught on this dilemma of one side, there's the fear of annihilation if we don't succeed in disempowering ourselves. And so when we start giving up the effort to disempower ourselves, we start getting jittery and worried. Plus we have the fear of if we do stop trying to disempower ourselves, we'll recognize our perfection, we won't know how to function. So it's kind of it's like a double whammy that we have going here. So that's why there's this cosmic spiritual culture that helps us with this double whammy and teaches us how to navigate what seems to be a very fearful situation. In this navigation, we have to be very compassionate with ourselves. Very compassionate, very patient, very compassionate, very loving, which is patience and compassion. And don't get angry at ourselves. We tend to go slow. Always the mind is saying, hey, I got this new defense, check this one out. This one looks really great. It starts out looking like it's really spiritual, but then later on you find yourself bogged down in great feelings of disempowerment. It's fantastic. Try this one out. And you have to say, no, I'm not interested. And just stay patient. And your mind will say, you're not making any progress. Why don't you try this defense? And actually say, no, I'm making a great deal of progress, mind, but I have this continuity fear. Kicks up and makes me feel kind of ignorant for a while. Clouds it over, it gets cloudy, but then, there's the sun. The clouds are thinning out. And then you see the sun, you see the clear sky, And then some clouds of fear come back in. So, you just have to say no, as the mind keeps saying, let's dance with this defense. Let's do this defensive dance. Dance of defensiveness. This is a good one. Listen to the rhythm, the tempo. You're gonna like this dance. It says, don't need it. I'm making real progress here. Really evaporating the continuity fear here. Some believe that just listening to nature is somehow what makes them happy. So they'll say, let's just listen to the rain here. And they say, I feel so relaxing or something. No, that's not it. It's hearing the truth and evaporating the continuity fear, which is how we make real progress. It's a discipline. It's like an exercise. It's like being a spiritual athlete, actually. Being a spiritual athlete. I wanted to be, when I was young, I wanted to be a spiritual athlete, and the cosmic corporate culture said, no, you can't do that here. You know, it's not allowed on this planet. I said, but look at the past. They did it. No, things have changed now. We found out a better way. So you're not allowed to do that. I said, wow, that's terrible. I want to. So I rebelled against it. But then they said, here's a substitute. You can be an athlete, you know. Instead of being a spiritual athlete, just be a human athlete. So it's like a compensation. And so I said, well, let me help, you know. I said, well, it's very poor compensation, but I'll try. So I wanted to be an athlete in the world. And excel at that. Excel, absolutely excel at it. And we find that much of what we do in the world is a compensation that this cosmic corporate culture has given to us as like a little piece of candy to get, so you let go of the real prize, you know. They say, look at this little bright thing, let go of this here, let go here, you can have this. And in fact, they insist that you let go of being a spiritual athlete. But what we need, cosmic spiritual culture, raises you up, the culture does, to be a spiritual athlete, to be a spiritual athlete. So that's what I'm getting back to now. And of course in athletics, you need discipline, focus, attention, you need your attention to be really keen on what it is you're trying to do. You can't get discouraged or down, you have to just remain confident, you know there's ups and downs, but you just can't give up. You know, there's all these disciplines that you need. Well, this is, and you know it's going to be a tough struggle. What you're up against is highly also trying to, you know, win and trying to prevail against you. So you really have to, you know, be very determined. Well, it's the same thing in as a spiritual athlete. You have to realize that what you're up against, the continuity fear, is a very tough opponent. You have to respect the opponent. Respect the opponent. Be a good sport. Respect the opponent. Understand it's there because we thought we needed it to avoid being annihilated. So thank it for its service. You know, thanks for being such great opposition. Be a great sportsman. Be a great spiritual sportsman. And this is how we can succeed. Don't hate on it. Of course, we will for a while, but the attitude we need to keep looking towards is, thanks so much for being there, because I thought I needed you to protect me from annihilation, and so you did a great job doing that. I really appreciate it. Now I see it wasn't really necessary, but I didn't know that at the time, so all is forgiven, you know, all is forgiven, and this is the right attitude to have. All is forgiven. One of the great proponents of cosmic spiritual culture is Jesus. And he says that the key is forgiveness for us, is forgiveness. Forgive ourselves for putting all these defenses in place, including this continuity fear defense. And thank it all, and be grateful, actually, that our creativity was able to do all this for us. In service to us, thank you for the service it's given us all this while. You know, it's like a good and faithful servant doing what we told it to do. So don't, you know, beat the servant and say, how terrible you did all this. No, I did exactly what we told it to do. Thank the servant. Honor the servant. Let's have a big ceremony for the servant. Exalt the servant for being a good and faithful servant. And we recognize that we don't need this particular service anymore, so we'll rehabilitate the servant to now give the appropriate service that we want. The appropriate service, you know, for what we want now, realizing there is no threat. We're not threatened. We can never be threatened with disempowerment. There is no threat to disempowerment. Reality is not threatened at all. And the service now is just to be blissful, be happy. Be happy. That's it. Instead of being fearful, be totally reassured and certain. blissful and calm and peaceful. So forgive ourselves, our creativity. Forgive ourselves for, you know, trying to scare ourselves and prevent us from realization, trying to prevent ourselves from realization. It's our own doing. It's our own handiwork. But we tried to make it seem like it wasn't, because if it was our own handiwork, we could always undo it, right? So the defenses work in a way where we try to insist that they're not our defenses, that they're just there. Some say that they're from God, put them there, or some say that they just evolved, you know. Either way, we're denying authorship of these defenses, thereby saying there's nothing I can do about them, really. I'm not in control of them. They're in control of me. I can't. Whereas if we realize that we're the author of these defenses, then we can say, oh, I can change them. Yeah, that's not a problem. I can really let them go. But then that raises tremendous fear. It says, no, I need them to be there. So we try to deny authorship. We deny authorship of this world, of bodies, of this world, of this universe. We deny authorship of it all. And we either claim that God's the author, or just somehow it authored itself. Neither one is true. We are the author of all of this dream, this fantasy. Therefore, we can set it down, right? And this is what makes us nervous. So cosmic corporate culture comes in and says, don't worry. You're not the author of any of this. You know, we'll teach you correctly. we'll educate you properly. We'll re-educate you so you never even have to worry about that again. We have the ways and the means to do this. And most people say, oh, what a deal. That's great. Because I've been really worried about this, you know. What if we actually are the authors of this? That means we could set it down, too, you know? And we'd have no defenses. We'd annihilate. This is terrible. So that's what we're up against is most of us here, you know, don't want to accept authorship of all this. But how else can we set it down unless we accept authorship of it? God's not telling us to set it down. God is not particular at all. God's not saying what we must do. We're free. We're absolutely free. God created us pure freedom. Perfect pure freedom. So God's not stipulating anything. Except that truth is true and nothing real can be threatened. God is reminding us of that fact that nothing real can be threatened. Cosmic spiritual culture just reminds us, hey, nothing real can be threatened and nothing unreal exists. That's all. It's only truth is true and nothing else is true. So just a general reminder of the nature of reality. It is not a stipulation that we're supposed to set all this stuff down, or that God can do it for us. God's not going to do it for us. God won't do it for us. We have to, we're the author of it. So we have to be the ones that decide, okay, I'm willing to go on to a different play with pure potentiality. I'm willing to do that. We cannot be forced. That would be denying our freedom. So you wonder why does God allow these defenses to keep dancing? We're perfectly free. God cannot stop. Tell us. He cannot stop it. God might say, remind us that we're free to stop it if we want to. Sure, God will remind us of the truth. But the truth is that we're free. And even God cannot impinge upon that freedom. Because that freedom is God, actually. God cannot impinge upon God. So we have to recognize authorship of this. We have to accept that we are the authors of all these defenses. And this symbolic dream of disempowerment. We're the ones. And so we're the ones who need to set it down. We have to decide. The decision is ours, not God's. It's ours. The decision for healed perception is our decision. And how are we going to do that if we deny deny, deny authorship, deny, deny, deny authorship, project, project, project it on God, project it on evolution. You know, we have these two options to believe. Either God did all this or evolution did all of it. The answer is neither one is true. We did it all. Spirit did it all. Now, this is touched upon a little bit, and touched upon in some religions. For instance, with Jesus, they say, well, Jesus is Lord of the universe, God of the universe. Jesus created the universe. Well, this is touching upon it, meaning the Son of God, Spirit, which is what we are, which is what we all are, Spirit. Spirit is the one, is the author of this universe, of this world, of all of us, not God. In Hinduism, for example, they would say Brahman. Brahman, this is all the work of Brahman, which correlates to the Son of God in Christianity. And then they say, but beyond Brahman is Parabrahman, which in Christianity would be God. God the Father, God the Prime Creator. But then the mistake is made thinking that humans are something, some other creation of Brahman or something. No. we're humans. No, we are spirit. We are Brahman. We are Brahman. We are the Son of God. And these bodies, this world, this universe, is just a symbolic dance of belief and representing disempowerment. They're not a body. I'm not a body and I'm free. I am still spirit as God created me. I'm still spirit. I am spirit. I am Brahman. I am the Son of God. I am spirit. And so this cosmic spiritual culture brings us to the realization, self-realization, that I am that. I am that. I am that which is the author of all of this. I am the author of this. But what is this? It's a fantasy, a symbolic fantasy. So the apocalypse means that we're being incorporated into this, these belief systems that we're being told that this is what we have to believe, that we're not the author of this, any of this. So if we believe this, how can we set it down? Obviously we won't set it down as long as we don't realize that we're the author of it, because then we think our freedom is being threatened, we're being dispossessed, God is attacking us, all this stuff, you know, makes it more fearful. So actually denying authorship of all this makes us more fearful, way more fearful. Because we feel somehow something is trying to put this down, set this all down. And we think it's something attacking us from outside. We think God is attacking us and telling us, trying to tear, rip this out of our hands, you know. Or we feel that some malevolent force, an evil force is trying to get us to set this down. You know? We feel we're being assaulted and attacked. This is the problem as we go along with denying our authorship of all this. But when we accept this, then we say, oh, I just have a continuity fear, and that's the only problem I have. You're right. God says, yes, that's exactly right. Only a continuity fear is all there is. Only problem there is. Then you don't feel attacked by, you know, you realize this is, I want to set it, I'm the author of it, and I want to set it down. I don't want this anymore. I dreamed this all up. We did it bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. So it's hard to write the history of it, dreaming it all up, right? We've been playing with these defenses and this symbolism, symbolizing disempowerment, but we've been playing with it for so long. And so this dream of disempowerment has, quote unquote, evolved as we play with it. We look back in history, we look, oh, look at the evolution of all of this form, et cetera, et cetera. But that's just been the evolution of our design in playing with this symbol of disempowerment, that's all. Evolution didn't do itself. We, Spirit, has been doing this and still is doing it. But we made it seem as though it's doing it itself. You see, that's the cleverness of it. so as that we can deny authorship of it, right? The whole point of it was to deny authorship of it so we wouldn't set it down. So we're dreaming a dream that seems to be dreaming itself. It's very tricky. And to our intellect, we say, I'm baffled, I can't. But to our spiritual intuition, we get it. We say, yeah, I know this is true. Even though I can't detail it, you know, the way the intellect wants it detailed, because the intellect just doesn't understand how this is possible. Jesus tells us it's a very, very intricate and complex and detailed and thorough illusion, symbolic play of disempowerment. And we've worked at it and worked at it and overworked at it and sculpted it and re-sculpted and sculpted it, you know, just to an extraordinary extent. So it seems very, very plausible, you know. I have to put out the trash in this rain. That should be fun. We're getting soaked in California right now. Getting soaked. Which is great. Been getting soaked all day. All day. It started about 7 in the morning or so. 7:38. It really started raining. And it's been coming down all day. Time is up. It's almost 7. So it's almost like 12 hours of continual, without stop, soaking. This is something that hasn't happened in a long, long time. We thought it may never happen again. Really. Really. We thought it may never happen again. But it's happening right now. Very cool. Music to our ears, really. We're just sitting here enjoying the sound. It's wonderful. Come on down, warm, moist air from the tropics. Pineapple, come on down, Pineapple Express. Keep on trucking, you know, keep on trucking, keep on sending it our way. 6 months of rain, which should do us good. Need about 20 feet of snow in the mountains. We might get it. Maybe the Pineapple Express will just keep on trucking. Like a conveyor belt, you know? He's got this conveyor belt going. It's really raining quite strong. It's gotten colder at night here. It's nighttime now, so it gets colder, brings more moisture out of the air. So the apocalypse, the incorporation here, where we deny authorship, where we reinvest in more and more different defenses, where we try to develop as many defenses as possible, where we educate ourselves that we believe there's no such thing as any way out of this. In fact, we don't even want out of it. This is our home. We believe it's our home. This is our fate. This is the way things are. All this. What happens when all this nonsense, it becomes the global program for everybody? We get, you know, become incorporated into this nonsense. And even the religions of the planet are trending towards, you know, they're being incorporated too, and they're watering it down. So now everything is just a matter of patting each other on the back and feeding the poor, which is fine, which is good. Charity is wonderful. Don't stop charity work. But there's more to it than charity work. So what they're doing is they're saying, let's just say that charity work is all there is to it. You know, and let's get it. Corporate culture says, that's great. Yeah, cosmic corporate culture says, sure, it's just charity work is what Jesus is really talking about. That's it. usually they tell you he's actually a worldly man. He married Mary Magdalene. They had children, and he just wanted everybody to be nice to each other and feed the poor, feed and clothe the poor, and be charitable. And that was his message. And they say, we agree. See, we're in agreement here. Let's all get along now. This is what they're saying. And you hear Jesus' real message, the real message of cosmic spiritual culture, and realize that what they're giving us here are just crumbs. Less than that. Tiniest of crumbs. And expecting us to feel well fed on those tiniest of crumbs. And so we're spiritually starved on this planet now. We're starving. I'm telling you, spiritual starvation is way worse than physical starvation. Way worse. And we're spiritually starving on this planet. When Jesus said, feed my flock, he said to Peter, feed my flock, feed my flock. He's talking about spiritual truth. Spiritual food. He said, when you eat the food that I have to give you, you'll have eternal life. You'll never die. You'll have eternal life. Of course not, because you'll sit down and disembowel, attempt to disempower ourselves, which is death is part of that nonsense. So feed my flock. Feed my flock. If you want to be part of that spiritual, cosmic spiritual culture, you need to feed those who are spiritually starving. And it's an outreach program for that. So that's what we're doing here. That's what we're doing here. It's part of an outreach program. Spiritual starvation is worse than physical starvation. But everybody in the world is spiritually starving. If you look at it from that standpoint, you say, wow. Of course, this is just a figure of speech, but the suffering seems to be quite acute. And you know, we feel desperate. Feel desperate. Like, right? We don't want this corporate nonsense, cosmic corporate nonsense. But we can't seem to get any food, we can't seem to assimilate, nothing to assimilate. Nothing to help our momentum. So when we feel stalled out, it's like spiritual starvation. We don't have anything to generate momentum. And we feel listless and stranded and stalled out. This is a terrible, terrible feeling. So how does this outreach program go forward in this world? I'm not sure. It's not going forward very well here, as far as I can tell. Maybe the spiritually starved will be relocated to a place where they can get some food, like refugees from a terrible war, this ideological war on this planet, as this planet's being incorporated, is horrible. And so like many conflicts, people who want to flee the conflict, they flee to another country as refugees, where they can get food. Where in the country they left, they couldn't get anything. All the transportation has been destroyed, the means of distribution has been destroyed, farms have been raised, scorched earth policy, all this kind of stuff. So they flee somewhere else. So maybe those who are spiritually starving may actually end up fleeing to some other place. It's possible. The more we tend to focus on the body, the more spiritually starved we tend to become. And this world right now is all about focusing on the body. It's sort of like a siege, laying siege to the planet so that we feel spiritually starved and eventually give up. Give up belief in the authorship of all this. Give up belief we can set it down. Give up belief that this is all just a symbolic dream of disempowerment and we don't need it. Give up belief that we can evaporate our continuity fear. Give up belief that God isn't angry with us. Give up our attempt to be greater than God. Give up all this. Repent, and be saved. We're being told, give it all up. We're trying to be spiritually starved and report, so we finally give up. Give it up. I don't want to be starved either. I'm no different than anyone else. Certainly not getting well fed here at all, spiritually. So maybe we'll start hearing some answers. I don't know how well anything can be shared in this world, because the reactivity, the phobic reactivity of culture, cosmic corporate culture sheeple, their phobic reactivity is so strong that how can you really do much of an outreach here is the question. So I've tried an outreach, but really, you know, it has had limited, you know, it's been quite limited. Most people in the world did this, said, no, cannot handle this, cannot, it's too much, forget it. So if I knew what's going to happen in the future, and I said what's going to happen, people, not many people would accept it. I don't believe they would. So I'm not sure. Maybe that therefore I don't know about. Maybe that burden has not been placed upon me. That's why I'm not being told. I don't have clear awareness of what exactly is going to happen. But something is going to happen. I am aware of that. I call it heading for the hills. Heading for the hills. But where are the hills? Is the question. Heading for higher ground. Heading for higher ground. Where is the higher ground? How to get there? Exactly like that. But we're about to find out. We're about to find out the answer to these questions. This much, it seems likely to me. So what are we doing now? We're getting very clear about what's going on, which helps us greatly. We recognize this plan has been incorporated into this cosmic corporate culture, which purpose of defensiveness and denying authorship of this, and to perpetuate fear, essentially, with ignorance, perpetuate ignorance and fear and defensiveness, which just makes things worse. Once we're aware of that, what's happened, then I think we'll feel much more stable in looking at our options. It is a difficult, tricky path, because you don't want to think this world is really a terrible place if you think you got to stay here, you know, and be part of this. You want to put a silver lining on it and say, well, it's not so bad. Whereas if you realize you do have options that are way better than this, then you won't be so frightened to look at it more objectively. Again, it's getting so watered down. We think we still have religion, cosmic, spiritual culture. We think we still, but it's been watered down again. Just look what they're doing to Jesus. It's been relentless, hasn't it? Relentless through all the means that this cosmic corporate culture have, like the magazines, the media, the news, the books, all this stuff is depicting them as a rabbi focusing on charity, and that's it. This is what they're doing. Then they have a pope now who's basically doing the same thing, saying the real message of Jesus is just this charity. That's it. This is what Pope Francis is doing, Jesuit. Let's narrow it down. Let's get rid of all the theology, all that stuff. Forget that stuff. I mean, forget looking at the big picture, the cosmic picture, the deep picture. No, no, no. You're not supposed to do that, basically. He says, you're supposed to just charity work. That's it. Don't do anything more. It's too dangerous. We don't want that. So we may have a pope now who is part of the cosmic corporate culture, saying, "Listen, kiddies, this is the new game in town here. And let me help you get here with it. And we get to keep our churches, get to keep stuff as long as we narrow our focus down. We'll go along to get along here, you know. It's like that. Whereas the pope before, Pope Benedict, said, no, 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 no." He said, it's way deeper. You know, this what's happening in the world is a very, very bad thing. And we're taking a hard line on all this stuff. We are not going to compromise. Very, very 180-degree different tone, right? 180-degree different tone. He, Pope Benedict, was standing up for cosmic, spiritual culture as best as he could stand. Very different tone with the new pope. Very, very opposite tone, actually. And yet, nobody disagrees about the cosmic corporate culture of a corporated planet Earth. Those who are getting with this, thinking this is it, they're cheering the Pope, saying, "You're doing a great job. This is wonderful, wonderful. We really love what you're doing. You're a hero to us. This is awesome. This is great. Finally, you get it, you know. Finally, you get it. You get the cosmic corporate culture and how to turn everyone into sheeple. Now we're making progress. Now we're getting there. Hallelujah," they say. They almost get religion from it. They're so happy. Yeah, focus it on. Narrow it down. So nobody even suspects that they can set this entire farce, this mirage of belief, fantasy, set it down. Set perception down for healing perception. No one even remotely imagines this possible, is it? No one remotely imagines that our own authorship of all this, right? No. Nothing can remotely imagine. You see, the cosmic corporate culture gradually want to wean us away from God, because even when we say God's the author, at least we're referencing God. You know, and referencing God, but referencing ourselves. So what they want to do ultimately is say, there is no authorship of it at all. It's unauthored, completely unauthored, no authorship. This is just the way it is, and don't think about it. That's the ultimate thing. But keep God around for a little while until people realize, we don't really need God anymore. There you know, it's just cold. It's probably snowing in the mountains. In fact, I'm sure it's snowing in the mountains. The creeks are raging right now, absolutely raging. They were dry as a bone not too long ago, a couple weeks ago, and now they're just raging, overflowing. Flooding everywhere. Flooding on the freeways, the roads. You drove through this road, it was flooded, and just storm drain couldn't handle it. You know, it was doesn't take much for storm drain to get blocked. I went down to the storm drains on the street here, and this morning, and I cleaned them all. I cleaned them up, got all the leaves and stuff out of them, and it's been draining beautifully all day long. People need to take responsibility for that and make sure your storm drains are clean. Absolutely. Make sure that your spiritual storm drains are clean so that the truth can flow into you. So, we're spiritually famished on this planet. Famished. Because a lot of the spiritual teachings we're getting are bogus. They've been narrowed down too much. And the thing is, there's a grain of truth to it. You still feel like, well, maybe this is something spiritual. I mean, it's like getting bread made of sawdust. You know, it looks like bread. I can slice it. It's a sawdust. It doesn't really nourish us. Because what nourishes us is the truth. And the truth is that this is all a dream of disempowerment. And we can't disempower ourselves. It's all futile, useless. We need to set it down. We have no choice but to set it down, really. It's not what we want. It's not what we want. We don't want fear. We don't want to live in fear. Based on a mistaken premise. And so we need to set it down. And realize we can't disempower ourselves. We can't disempower God. And that's it. So this is the food we need to hear. not the justice, the crumbs of charity, which makes everybody feel good about it, right? But charity without faith is not enough. Okay? You need the faith there in truth. You need to hear the truth also. Now, traditionally, charity, when works of charity are done by religions, they also evangelize those that they're giving charity to and share the truth with them. Look, this is what is done, of course. They're not just doing charity only for the sake of charity. They're doing charity also for the sake of nourishing the soul, too, nourishing the body and the soul. But now, it's being narrowed down to only nourishing the body. And you're not supposed to evangelize those who are giving charity to at all. That's taboo in cosmic corporate culture. That's taboo. How dare you? How dare you try to feed the spirit and the body too? They say, no, the spirit doesn't exist. It's only the body. What are you doing talking to them? You're just confusing them and spreading malicious lies. That's what they say. So, you know, this is the trend in the world. The corporation that rolls out is telling you, you can't evangelize anybody. It's against the law. It's abusive. In fact, that is diabolical. Here you are giving shelter and food and helping out sick people, helping them, your needy people, and you're using that opportunity of their desperation to share the truth with them, to evangelize them. How awful, how terrible. Now, of course, that's enough. I mean, this is where we're going. This is where we're going. Make it illegal to at least say something about salvation, at least use the words and terminology, even though it's all confused because of our fear, at least they're referencing cosmic spiritual culture, saying, you know, I think there's something helpful that is beyond the reach of cosmic corporate culture. It's something else. You have an option other than that. It's not the only option. It's not the only game in town. Now, they may not be able to explain it right, and they don't explain it very well. But at least they're saying there is another option. So that's very important. There is another option. And of course, cosmic corporate culture does not want that information getting out at all. So they say, no evangelization when they give you charity. No. Wicked, terrible, deceitful, malicious, harmful. Deplorable. Yeah, and, you know, everybody gets on Twitter and Facebook and so whatever they do, you know, Instagram, the whole apparatus of pressure and bullying, and you know, they're gonna, you know, bring up all these cases and hammer people down, hammer them down, constant hammering down taking place. Now, anyone who dares do anything that cosmic corporate culture does not approve of. And of course, the ones who think they're in tune with what cosmic corporate culture does approve of, they think they're very progressive. They call themselves progressives. We're very progressive. We've been able because of our higher intelligence, we've been able to understand what cosmic corporate culture really wants from us. We've been able to discern it. It makes us very, very advanced, and we're sharing this advancement with you, and we're helping nurture you along so you can be clued in and know what's expected of you too. Yeah, it is very progressive. They're very, very pleased with themselves to know what's expected of them. As good little sheep, what's expected of them? Yeah, good. Very good. Hey, now I get it, you know. And so they bully. Everyone hammer them down when they dare, you know, not get it. So you don't get it yet. You haven't gotten it yet. You need to get it. You need to get it. There's something wrong with you. You're not getting it yet. You got depression. You need to get it. How about get out of it? How about that getting it? Let's get out of it. So I don't know exactly what cosmic spiritual culture will do. We have some clues, of course. We have some hopes. But it's important to know there is this option. And we've known about this option on this planet. Say, hey, and we've been told that we'll be incorporated. We were warned about this. But I said, don't forget that there is this option as you go through this incorporation, this horrible, horrible time, the last 60 years or so, really. You could say 100 if you want, but yeah, let's just say the last 100. We've been incorporated, this planet's been incorporated into this cosmic corporate culture. It'd be very terrible. But don't lose sight of the prize, don't lose sight of your options. It's pretty difficult now because we're all getting hammered down and bullied. And we realize the writing's on the wall that if you don't get it at some point, you know, they'll say, listen, we have some stronger ways for you to get it. Right now it's a bunch of apologies, you know, hand-wringing and tears. I'm so sorry I said this. I don't know what I was thinking. In fact, I'm so sorry I referenced some other option other than what you're telling me. I feel so terrible. I'm so sorry. I don't know what I'm thinking. I'm, you know, but please accept my apologies, and I hand in my resignation. I know, I hope my life is ruined because of this. I'm so sorry for offending anyone, but those who do get it. I'm so sorry I offended those who do get it by suggesting there might be another option. I'm so sorry, you know, I did this. And they still say, well, still, we can't really forgive you for that one. You know, but we'll kind of sweep it out of the rut now, but then later on they'll say, you know, we got to use some stronger methods to help you get it. Much stronger methods to help you get it. Because it's really offending us that you don't get it. It's really offending us and frightening us that you don't realize there is no other option other than cosmic corporate culture. There is no other option. In fact, to believe there is insanity. And it's really, your insanity is making us really nervous, you know. And so they're going to, you know, use, you know, stronger means to help you help them by getting it. They want you to help, they want to help you help them. And with all you need to do is just get, understand what is required of you. What it is that you're supposed to do, how you're supposed to think, how you're supposed to act. What's expected of you, you're supposed to know what's expected of you. Which is to be oblivious to any other option is what's expected of you. Oblivious. Oblivion. So we're keeping our spirits high by looking at this with humor, light-hearted humor, looking at it all and saying, oh, isn't this all so awful? And wouldn't it be great to not get it, but get out of it? Get out of it, get out of it, get out of it. We're not here to get it, we're here to get out of it. And you can get that. You know, we're getting out of it, get that. You want us to get it? We're getting out of it, get that. And they say, well, you're making me feel very uncomfortable and nervous. I said, well, you're making us feel very uncomfortable and nervous by you're telling us there's no option. that's really cause for nervousness, right? To be incorporated into no optionness, you know, like that. Basically, in other words, denying the option of truth. And in fact, truth is all there is. If you want to turn it around that way, too. But that'd be level confusion from what we're talking about right now. So you say, yeah, let's get it that we're getting out of it, because you're making us nervous. Say, well, can't we compromise? I mean, don't get out yet. We'll find some way to help you get it. Don't worry, we're working on it. We're working on some medications for you. We're working on some expert therapy for you. We'll actually have some camps we can send to you and have expert therapists work on you, combination medication and group pressure and all this stuff. You know, we should be able to help you get it. And so when they say, can't we compromise, they think you're insane. And so they think they're doing you a service by telling you just, you know, delay your insanity a little bit longer until we find a cure. You know, like that. Don't leap into getting out of it, because then you'd be annihilated or something. So when they're saying compromise, this is just a therapeutic trick they're using. They don't even know what compromise means, because they're denying there's any option at all to compromise on. So how could they believe what they're saying? They're not. They're not. They are not. Compromise would mean work gradually to evaporate your continuity fear. That's the only compromise there is. It's the only compromise there is. And that's just a matter of time, you know, how long you take. But it's not a substantial, it's not a compromise on truth at all. But so they don't even recognize truth. So what they say, I think they're talking about insanity. So they say, we don't want you to go too far because, you know, you could cause us all to be annihilated. So just slow down. We'll find the answer soon. Don't worry. Got a lot of research going on. They're very nervous. They're very nervous. Like, oh, we got to find that cure soon. Find the cure. Find the cure. The whole planet will be watching. Find the cure. We're trying to help cure these people. We're still stuck in this archaic religious belief that, you know, maybe they can be saved from all this, from death. Of course, Jesus says exactly the goal of all this is eternal life, to recognize eternal life. We are eternal life. All is eternal life. This very instant, there's only eternal life, as a matter of fact. All is eternal life. Right now, there's only eternal life. Nothing else other than eternal life. That's all there is. This is true right now, and always true. And of course, we can see it that way. But they call that, that's total insanity. Totally insane. You've gone completely insane, incurably insane. What's happened is we've become incurably sane. Okay? We've become incurably sane. In other words, we will not fall into insanity again because we recognize the situation as it really is. So if I just keep on talking and sharing and giving us spiritual food here, as long as it keeps raining and keep talking, well, we'll be here a long time because this rain doesn't show any sign of abating and it's supposed to go all the way through to the morning. Another 12 hours. The rainfall totals, I always wonder about that because if there's like a lot of wind, the rain is not falling straight down, it's being driven sideways. How does it fall into the rain gauge? It doesn't really. So I believe that usually the rainfall totals are actually more than what they're reporting. It's really gusty. It's gusty. Right now the rain is falling straight down. There's no wind. Much less wind than they told us would happen. At least where we are. It's been very calm actually. No tree branches fell down at all. It was amazing. Thank God for that. Wow. Thank goodness for that guy. It's not actually causing any of this at all. But figure speech. It's the wind that causes the havoc. So again, with spiritual awareness, we can reference this world. It can be functional, very sane as far as functioning in a semi-corporate way, okay? It's the opposite that's not true. Whereas those who are trying to obtain oblivion of any option are not even, how can they function? They don't insist there is no such option to even function as. They don't know how to. They don't know how to. Whereas the opposite is not true. We know how to function, at least in this world, in this situation. Because we're not denying the situation, we realize there's two options to choose from, either delay or ending delay. That's it. There are still two options to choose from. Whereas they say there's only one option, it's delay. That's it. It's just, how do we keep delay going? Is the options they have is, how do we keep delay going? I think that's the options. Whereas we say the option is choose between delay and setting delay down, no more delay. Path of delay or the path of setting delay down? The path of trying to disempower ourselves or the path of setting this attempt to disempower ourselves down? Two different paths. We're aware of both those paths and aware that we have the right to make a choice, but we have to make a choice. Whereas they say, no, there is no other option, no choice. That's the whole point of their path, is to say, there is no choice, there is no option. It doesn't exist, never will exist. That's what they say. So how can they appreciate what we're talking about, the option we're talking about? How can they understand it? How can they appreciate it? How can they function as it? They cannot. So this idea that the cosmic corporate culture is going to be a very inclusive situation is totally bogus. It's going to completely exclude cosmic spiritual culture on this planet. It's at its aim to completely exclude it. Because that the whole point is for them to say there is no such option. It doesn't exist. It's delusional. That's the whole point of the direction they're going in. So, of course, they can't function with appreciation, understanding, and properly function on this path at all. They're trying to say there is no such path. It doesn't exist. It's all delusion. So they're not nice. They're not tolerant. They're not inclusive. It's just the opposite. Cosmic corporate culture is super, super exclusive, super discriminatory, super intolerant, super prejudiced, super phobic, super bigoted, super everything that they're claiming that they're not, they actually are, severely so. Because they're trying to completely exclude cosmic spiritual culture, completely exclude it, and insist it's never existed and never can exist and never will exist. There's no such thing. It's nothing. It doesn't. This is total exclusion, oblivion. They want to be oblivious to it. How tolerant is that? How inclusive is that? The answer is obvious, of course. So do you want to really live in such an intolerant society and culture and place? Does anyone really want that? Because that's what you're going to get. That is what you're going to get. And the signs are just, you know, so many, many indications that you have to be deaf, dumb, blind, and drunk to not... to not see it, the writing on the wall. The writing on the wall. It's been blatant, completely blatant. So look at it this way. Who wants to live in such a bigoted, intolerant, exclusive, excluding, prejudicial culture? Such a terrible, intolerant culture. Terribly intolerant. The essence of intolerance. Who wants to be part of that? Who wants to lend their creativity to that, their attention, lend their attention to such a culture? Now you should say, no way, no way, no way, no way. And don't let level confusion trap you here, okay? Don't go there at all. Don't go there at all. That's a trick, because you start feeling your freedom. You start throwing level confusion into it. And say, wait a minute, doesn't truth exclude lies? isn't truth being exclusive, you know, intolerant of lies? No, no. Because we're saying, if you want to continue on with lies and delusion, you're free to do so, absolutely free to do so. So it's not intolerant of lies at all. If you want to continue on delay, you're absolutely free to do so. It is not intolerant. It recognizes lies. It recognizes delay. It says this too is a play with pure potential. So it's not exclusively intolerant at all. It's just saying you're completely free to choose again. You're completely free to choose once you choose something else. Some other play with pure potential. Absolutely free is all it's saying. And if you want to say, well, insisting that you're totally, perfectly free is a form of exclusion. You're excluding non-freedom. Well, you can go ahead and think that if you want. But Jesus says even you in your confused state are not going to buy that one. You know that freedom is somehow imprisoning because it's not limiting itself somehow. It's not. Of course, you look, it's nonsense. You know, but that's essentially what you're trying to sell yourself. Very steady right there. Very steady. It's hardly varied at all. Not a single burst that hasn't really let up. It's just been relentlessly steady. We may think, oh, this solves the problem, but keep thinking these people got their wells down. I read somewhere like 3,000 feet or something to get water. It takes a long time for this water that's landing on the surface of the soil here to go down 3,000 feet. You know, to start refilling those aquifers, the underground groundwater. It takes a while. I don't know how long it goes, but it takes a while. Several feet a week. I don't know how fast it goes. It's possible to go several feet in a week's time. 52 weeks. Several feet, 52 weeks is 100 and... Well, that's not very good. Even when 3 feet in a week, that's 100. In 1 year, it's 156 feet. You're supposed to go down 3,000 feet. Whoa. That's bad. 30 years or something to get down there from. Yikes. That's not good. I think it's supposed to be like 6 inches in a day or something. So 6 inches, 2 days is a foot, 4 days is 2 feet, 6 days is 3 feet. So a week is like 3.5 feet per week. That's, you could say even 200 feet in a year, getting down 3,000 feet. Okay, that wouldn't take that long. 15 years. 200 feet in a year. 300. Whatever. It takes maybe 5 years. Okay. So we're talking around maybe 5 years to get that far. Or more than that. More than that. 15 years, 10, 5, 10, 15 years. A long time, a long time. Yeah, a long time. It takes a long time for truth. Well, there's a drought of truth. Or when there's a planet that has been under the spell of cosmic corporate culture, it takes a long time for truth to resaturate. It's slow. We're so frightened. It's terrible. That's why I say it's terrible to get into that sort of culture. It makes it very difficult to assimilate truth. You're very hesitant and fearful and very feeble. It makes everyone very feeble in their approach to it. And very erratic, very feeble. They don't have the confidence to go after it every day with confidence. They might make fits and starts and bursts and then give up, And they easily collapse. They collapse back into futility easily. Say, oh, there's no such option. They lose their faith easily. These are the problems. These are very, very severe problems that they encounter. Anyway. Apocalypse. We're in apocalypse. Time of the apocalypse now. Truth is not discriminatory. Okay? It's not exclusive, as they try to claim. They try to throw level confusion at us. It's not true. It's a lie. We're free to engage in fantasy with lies and delusion and disempowerment. We're absolutely free. That is not excluded from our experience. We can imagine this experiencing. We're free to do so. No one is saying that we can't. No one is demanding that we not. We're saying that there are options and we can choose, is what we're saying. There's a choice. To say that there's a choice is not being exclusive. Saying that there's no choice, and that we don't have any option to choose between. That's being very exclusive. What we're saying is, everyone will make the choice. Because there isn't any other choice to make between truth and lies. There isn't any other choice between the belief in disempowerment and realizing we can't disempower ourselves. Now, we're not free to change God, reality. So there's no choice there at all. There's no choice there, but just how it is. And if we don't like it, well, we don't like it, but that's how it is. We cannot change the nature of reality. We're not created with that function at all. But we can choose to believe that we can. We're free to do that. But we can't actually ever do it. Anyway, just trying to give nourishment here, but this is probably enough. It's starting to get, you know, a little bit, say, okay, that's enough. That's enough for now. Because this takes us on a deeper tangent, sorry, another tangent. So we'll just wind it down now. And see, we're free to do that. We don't have to, if we see a tangent, we don't have to take that tangent. We don't have to push further. We'll just say, okay, that's enough for now. We pointed out so much already. So the apocalypse, back to the apocalypse, back to the apocalypse. Let's just refocus on the apocalypse. Time of choice is the apocalypse, the time of choice. And do you want to have healed perception, or do you want to go on with the belief that there's no such thing as healed perception? This is the choice. This is the choice we have. Do we want to believe that that healed perception is possible, or do we want to insist that there's no such thing as healed perception? And the very notion of it is crazy. Is that what we want? This cosmic corporate culture, that's what they will give us. That's what we'll get. And if we can say, no, I don't want that. I don't want that. So apocalypse, time of choice. Apocalypse, time of choice. Time of choice. So get in this mode and this mood of, you know what? I'm seeing it more clearly now. I'm seeing that there is a choice. And just keep feeding that clarity of choice. All right. Very good. That's it.